Hello and welcome to the 16th part of my LEGO Powered Up tutorial that you can use for Powered Up, Control Plus and LEGO Boost. You can already see what we want to do today, because today we want to make a layout to remote control the train. In the next part we will discuss how to motorize railway crossing. You can already see it there, but today we will cover how to control the train. And you might think that it's pretty easy. You can simply add a widget like this and turn return to zero to false. And then you can use the output of this widget in the program to control the train motor. It's possible to do that, but this option has one major disadvantage at the moment, because you can't go directly to the zero position. There's no stop button, and you would have to get the zero position precisely, or you have to match the position of the slider exactly to the zero position, and that's pretty difficult and would stop the fun. So I decided to make my own layout to control a train and to add a stop button. It's possible that we will get better options for this in the future with future updates, but at the moment, when I'm recording this part, I will have to use this option. And I want to have a speed output for the train. I want to have two buttons, one to make it faster and one to make it slower, or to slow it down. You can use this type of button with two sub buttons. And I want to have a button to stop the train. Now we can go into the settings of the widgets. First to the first widget, and here we can select the icons to be shown on both of these buttons. I want to show a plus and a minus to get faster or to get slower. And we have an advanced setting which is called incremental, because at the moment the value or the output of the slider is zero. It will get to 100 if we press the plus button, and it will get to minus 100 if we press the minus button. We can set this to incremental, and then it will add, I think, 10 or 1 each time we press the plus button. But the problem with that is that there's no option to reset it to 0. So we would have the same problem. So I won't use incremental, but we will use our own variable, and then we can increment the value on our own. For the button, I want it to have a stop icon, so I will use this icon. And now we can go into the program. I think the easiest to do is to implement the stop button. For that, we can use a trigger. I will use this trigger. The difference between both of these triggers is that this triggers as long as the input is 1, and this triggers only if the input goes from false to true or from 0 to 1. So this triggers only once when we press the button, and this triggers as long as we press the button. But I want to trigger only once. That's enough. We could use the other one as well, but then it would trigger more often. So we can use the input of the button. It has the number 2. And then we can set the speed to 0. I will use a variable to store the speed, and I will use a normal variable, no global variable for that. And next, we have to implement the increment and decrement of the variable. I will do that in a loop. We already covered loops in the past parts, so that we can always react to inputs. And we want to change the value of the variable to the new speed. We need the old speed variable, or the old speed value for that. And we want to add the new value to the old value, and to the change. To change it, we have this input. It is between minus 100, 0 and 100. But I want to increment and decrement the speed in steps of 10. So I will divide that by 10. And computers are pretty fast. So this wouldn't take long to run. So I will add a delay of a tenth of a second for the trigger. So now, as long as we hold the button, it will add or subtract 10 to or from the value as long as we press the trigger. So it's not triggered only once when we press it, but every tenth of a second. It won't check if we press the button if it's on the wait block. You will have to keep that in mind and don't make the wait block too long. But of course, you can adjust that if you want to have another delay, if it's not fast enough or if it's too fast. So we want to add an output. Here we can simply output the speed variable. Keep in mind that the train motor doesn't have a speed measurement unit, so we can't use the speed measurement, or we can't measure the speed with the motor. So we will have to use the output of the variable, even if it's not the actual speed. And of course, we have to set the speed to the motor, so we can use the variable's input for the speed. But in my case, the motor is the wrong way around, so the motor has to turn backwards in order to drive forwards. And we already had a solution for that. We can multiply the output of the speed with minus 1. So now let's try it out, and I will run the program for the train crossing with another Bluetooth device, so that you will see how it works, but we will discuss the functions in a future part, or in the next part. Let me switch to the webcam, and I can show you the input that I give. And now I can press the plus button, and the train will get faster. I can stop at the station if I press the stop button, and then the crossing closes, and we can drive another round, and we can drive again. So that works pretty well. Keep in mind that you can hold the plus button to get faster, or you can press it single times, and it works pretty good for me. But you might have to adjust the delay if your smartphone is faster or slower than my device. Anyways, that was it for this question. In the next part, we will discuss the railway crossing. There we will discuss parallel code execution. So make sure to tune in for that. Thanks for watching. See you in the next part, and bye.